Namaskar. We have with us Swami Ishwarananda ji, General Secretary of Yogada Satsanga Society. A doctor by training and has chosen this vocation since 1988. And his entire life he wants to dedicate to the service of man and service of mankind. Swamiji, welcome. Swamiji, we have a very regimented life in today's world where we have work and we also have our own families. The general question which nowadays arises is that how far is it practical in order to have a meditation 30 minutes in the morning and 30 minutes in the evening?
Before I answer the question, I would like to say that this regimen of meditating morning and evening was made popular and prescribed by Paramahansa Yoganandaji, who founded this organization to which I belong, Yogada Satsanga Society of India. You see, our guru, Paramahansa Yogananda, who is the author of this book, Autobiography of a Yogi, he explained that man is not the body. He is essentially a soul. And just like the body needs food for its sustenance, mind needs some creativity, some intellectual pursuit for its sustenance. Similarly, our soul needs meditation for its sustenance. And soul being the springboard, it is a source of all life. It is a source which sustains mind and body. His plea was that we have to recognize that need of the soul and cater to it. And he said that anyone who is not meditating and thus providing food for the soul is missing out on a lot of things. And eventually his mind and body also will feel that lack of meditation. So the question is, how much importance we give to our soul? If you see any activity which we think is important, we will find time for that. So if you think that meditation is important, and it is vital for me, half an hour in the morning and evening can easily be included in our schedule. You know, that reminds me of a small story by the great saint. The same question was posed to that saint: how can we meditate, how can we do Ishwar Chintan in today's world? And that today's world was, this is a story dating back nearly 100 years. And even in those days, people were busy. It's not that today people are busy. And you know what that saint said? He said, even when the stomach is full, there is always the place for two rasagullas, because you like rasagullas. So similarly, if we understand the importance of meditation, we will find time.
That's nice. And in today's world, where we have a world where with a lot of expectations, yes. How do we go about it with this meditation without expectation?
What is it that man is expecting? Behind every action, what is the singular motive? That is joy and happiness. You analyze any activity man does, whether it is studies or pursuing some ambition or marriage or having children. What is it that man is looking for behind these actions? He is looking for happiness. So that is the expectation. And the same expectation we can have when we meditate. Nobody does anything without expectation. Yogis who spend their whole lives meditating, they also have the expectation that through meditation, they will contact that supreme joy. So it is not that meditation is just a blankness and you don't get anything in return. You get much more than you asked for. You get much more than you expected. So we should enter meditation with the expectation that yes, it is going to bring a fulfillment in my life. It is going to bring me supernal joy, and that expectation will be fulfilled. So it's not that meditation is done without expectation. However, the expectation is not a material benefit, but a spiritual benefit. And that expectation is more than fulfilled.
This age, we have these youngsters and also we have the middle-aged people. They go in for a lot of gym workouts and they go. And how do we motivate them to get back to this spiritual world?
Well, we don't need to actually discourage people who are trying to keep their bodies healthy, because that is also very important and we should encourage that. However, at the same time, if we can explain to the current generation that what the saints tell us, that we are not just the bodies. This body is like a vehicle which has been given to us, and our essential nature is the soul, And just like they are working out, they are going to the gym to keep their bodies fit. Meditation is the gym where your soul becomes fit. So it is the internal exercise which we do to connect with the soul. And once they realize that, yes, that is what the whole purpose of life is, then automatically they will find time for meditation also. But we need not discourage this culture of gym and physical fitness, because it is better than having an unhealthy body. So that it's a good thing. But along with that, they should also include meditation.
And how early, Swamiji, can we start this meditation? Is there any age restriction?
Yes, Paramahansa Yoganandaji usually prescribed that before one starts serious meditation and does pranayam, one should be 12 years or more. But for introducing a child to spirituality, to our spiritual culture in India, the lives of saints, the concept of God, and the concept of soul, and our relationship with that loving God, that can start even at the age of 3 or 4 years old, as soon as the child is able to communicate with the parent. But serious meditation, 12 years or more.
And do you feel that it should be made mandatory in all the schools?
Yes, I feel so, because what we are teaching in the schools is only educating the intellect and to some extent physical culture by exercises and sports and all that. But no recognition is given to the fact that we have another dimension, and which is the most important dimension of our personality, which is the soul. So that also has to be included in our education at some level, maybe in the middle classes, if not in the younger, lower classes. So it should be made mandatory. And when I say meditation and yoga, you see, now the current trend is to include yoga in the schools. That is happening. But there, the concept of yoga is again physical fitness, only asanas. And that is again limiting that great science, what it has to offer. Yoga is not just the asanas which are taught in the schools. It also includes higher techniques of mental concentration and mental interiorization. That also should be promoted in our schools.
And can you just guide us on how to go about with the meditation?
Meditation is very simple. When we are engrossed in one particular subject, for example, you are watching a very favorite TV program, then all of us know that no matter how much disturbance is happening around, we are able to watch and enjoy the TV program. So what have we done? We have been able to concentrate our mind. We have been able to shut off all the other distractions and focus on one particular activity. And that is what we call as mental concentration or concentration of the mind. What Paramahansa Yoganandaji tells is that most people do not know the capacity we have to concentrate. Most of us use only 5% of the mind power we have. But through certain techniques of meditation, we can increase this capacity more and more until it becomes 100%. Wherein, when we focus on a particular thought, nothing else exists except that thought. And that is perfect mental concentration. When we are able to shift that concentration, or put that concentration, the full concentration of the mind on God, some aspect of God, that is meditation. So meditation is focusing the concentrated mind on some aspect of God. Now, to understand how that is done, we have to understand that what is distracting us. The biggest distraction are these five senses, our two eyes, our two ears, the nose, the tongue, and the skin, which keep us locked in this body, which make us feel that we are only this body. So what the yogis found is that there is a way by which I can switch off these senses, and then those outer distractions do not reach my brain, and then I can focus my mind on any particular thought which I choose to. And that is the entire process of pranayam. Pranayam means control of our prana, and prana is that invisible electricity which powers these five senses. Just like these lights we have, when you switch off the electricity, the lights go off. Similarly, these five senses are like five searchlights which are looking towards the world. By pranayama, we switch off the electricity in these senses and take that electricity into our spine and brain. So through that, we are able to completely focus on the presence of God within us, and that is called pranayama, and the next step pratyahara. So that is meditation. So essentially, it is reversing the flow of the prana away from the senses and into the spine and brain. So there are many techniques to do that, and the Kriya Yoga path, which Paramahansa Yogananda teaches, is a very high technique which accomplishes this.
That's very beautifully said about it. And Swamiji, practically in today's world, we have a lot of gurus where we do not, where a citizen is not able to know about the commercial and whether it is done in the right spirit. How will a citizen be able to identify that?
Well, how does anyone know about the genuineness or the truth or the authenticity of a product? One has to have the interest to find out whether it is true or not. I mean, it is simple. If you want to buy a particular dress or if you want to buy a house, you do a lot of research, isn't it? You go to the market, you ask different people, you read about that building if there is some literature available. And then after searching and looking at several buildings, you zero in and locate one building which you think is good. So when we are putting in so much effort to just buy one building or even purchase a book or put our children in one particular school, if the same amount of energy is devoted in looking for a spiritual path, then we will find the genuine spiritual path. There are several genuine spiritual paths and genuine spiritual teachers, and people can choose any one of them, but they have to make the effort to find out which one is authentic. And your own soul will tell you. I mean, we have enough common sense, we have enough intelligence within us to guide us to the right path, but we have to put in the effort. Absolutely. And plus, from my own personal experience, what I found was that prayers help. You know, we do not, in today's society, praying to God is kind of underrated. But in my own life, I have found that if we pray to the God, any God, there is only one God. And if we pray to that God, that indwelling Lord within us, asking Him to direct us to the right path, we will receive the guidance. And that is how I found my path. So spend the time, look around, read the lives of saints and pray, and we will be guided to the right path.
Swamiji, you have been a doctor, and the scientific beliefs, they say that they do not have something of empirical evidence. So if you can share with us your journey to come to this new spiritual world.
Even when I was in class 9 or 10, I had interest in spirituality. I was reading the lives of saints, and I came across the life of Ramakrishna Paramahansa, Swami Vivekananda, and I was inspired by them. And then I started looking around, who is my guru, which is the path which is most suited to me. And I started praying for it, and I was guided to come to this path. Somebody came to me and told me about this path, and that is how I came to know. Now, that is where the journey started. At the same time, almost at the same time when I became a lesson student of Yogada Satsanga, I also joined the medical college, and my college career also started. You know, all the teachings, all the yoga teachings of Paramahansa Yogananda, they are in the form of printed lessons. And I was getting those printed lessons by post. You know, even now we do that. These lessons are available to any truth seeker who applies for them. These lessons are sent by post. So those lessons were coming to my home. And when I started reading them and applying the meditation techniques which are given in them, I found that they opened a whole new dimension in my life which I was completely unaware of. Though I had interest in spirituality, though I had a vague concept of God and saints and their spiritual experiences. They were all intellectual. I had no personal experience of my own. But when I started practicing meditation, it opened up a whole new dimension within me. And I had a few experiences of deep peace and joy, of connecting with the divine within, which gave me very convincing proof that if just by practicing for a few months, I can experience this, then what the saints are talking about that supreme experience of the joy of God, the Satchitanand, that may be possible for me in my lifetime. So that is what made me very serious about my meditation. So I gave enough time, enough priority to my meditations as much as I was giving for my studies in the medical college. And you won't believe it, but even though I was spending less time in my studies, I never, my performance in my exams, everything was quite okay. I did not fall back because of spending time in meditation. Actually, it helped. So this journey continued. And eventually, as I progressed in my meditation, more and more I realized that this is what I want to do, to train myself, to train my mind, to train my consciousness more and more so that I can be in that state of joy all the time. And plus, be of service to humanity by spreading this message of Kriya Yoga, which gives so much joy, which gave so much joy to me, and I wanted that same joy to be experienced by everyone else. So that is how I changed my vocation from becoming a doctor and became a sannyasi.
Wonderful. That's a wonderful thing. And Swamiji, this is the greatest challenge for in today's world, to motivate the youngsters to get into the spiritual world. Can you give us tips on how to motivate them?
The biggest way to motivate them is by our own personal example. You know, today's youth, they do not believe in theory, and they will not accept you or your word just because you say it and you are an elder. They have to be given proof. And that is where Paramahansa Yoganandaji's teachings are so valuable, because you don't have to blindly believe in what somebody says. You can put those techniques into practice and experience for yourself. So I think if we convey this to the youth, first of all, that there is a invisible hidden dimension within us which is far greater than what this world has to offer. That message has to be conveyed. And second, we can tap into that dimension by practical techniques. That is why Paramahansa Yoganandaji said that Kriya Yoga is scientific. You know, what is science? Science is something which no matter who applies, he gets the same result. That is why it is called science. It is not dependent on a particular person or a particular circumstance. It is universally applicable. So similarly, if this youth can be convinced to practice meditation, the path of Kriya Yoga, and they are able to experience for themselves, then they don't need any more proof, because they are experiencing on their own. Then they don't need convincing. They are already convinced. So that is where we have to work. First of all, we have to prove to ourselves by our own example that this path is true and the experience of God can be had and it is real. And through our life, then we can convince others. And plus, in today's world, because the youth is hooked into this electronic media, digital media, I think we should make creative use of this digital media to get this message across, that this dimension of life also exists and they should try it. So then they will be convinced.
Swamiji, when we talk about these challenges and we also motivate the youngsters about the spiritual world, they come up with one question, that is, the world is facing so many problems, so many social problems and all. Don't you think it is impractical for all of us to implement this spiritual world? That's again another one challenge. What do we say and how do we go about it?
True, these are burning issues, and because problems such as the social unrest, the inharmony between the various nations, fight between people on the basis of religion or nationality, pollution, global warming. All these are looming dangers which occupy and with which the youth are preoccupied, and that is true, and they should be, because it concerns the whole world. But again, if you analyze these problems, what is the root of this? It is essentially man's selfishness and man's disregard for other people, disrespect for other people, and disrespect for Mother Nature. It all boils down to this. Now, what is the source of the regard and respect a person has for another person or for nature? It is a knowledge, consciousness that I am not alone. I belong to this entire world family, and that concept of Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, which is very much there in the Indian philosophy. And mankind today is divorced from that, he is far away from that. Usually societies, communities, they are thinking only about themselves. There is no consciousness of a global village, which some people are trying to promote, but it is not taking root. And that is because people have not been taught what is the basis for this feeling of global village or Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, which means that entire world is my family. That basis can only come when man experiences the divinity within, and then sees that the same divinity is there in everyone, which is what the saints talk about. And that has to be an experience, it cannot be just an intellectual concept. So right now, why this idea of global village and the world as a family is not taking strong root is because it is still at the level of the intellect. Man has not experienced that inner kinship. He is not able to feel. You see, a man is able to feel a strong bond with his own family, and so he will do anything to save his family. The same thing, the same kind of love a saint feels for the entire world, and that is why he is able to overcome his selfishness and think of the welfare and the benefit of the entire world. And what is the difference between a saint and an ordinary person? A saint has connected his consciousness with God's omnipresence. He is able to see God in everyone, and that is why he is able to feel the same kind of love for everyone. So don't you think, by meditation, by following a spiritual path, if man's consciousness expands and is able to feel the same kind of kinship which he feels with his family, with everyone, will that not be the end of wars? You know, as one great statesman said, war begins in the minds of men. Where does war begin? It in the minds of men. So what we have to do is remove the thought of war from the minds of men. That means we have to move towards a state of the world where man stops thinking about war and starts thinking more about love and giving love to others. And all that can happen when man goes within and connects with that source of love, which is God. So to say that these are burning issues and we have no time for meditation is like putting the cart before the horse. We have to discover that fountain of love within us. And when we are able to tap into that fount of love, then we can express that love outwards. And automatically, many of these various problems which are facing mankind today, they will disappear. So what I would say to the youth of today is, yes, these problems are real, these global issues are important, but find the right solution, go to the source. And if one is really sincere, he will realize that unless man changes within, he cannot change the world. And what is meditation? It is changing ourselves. It is overcoming our narrow selfishness and connecting with God's omnipresence, which is in, and realizing that spark in everyone.
If I think I can, I can. That is what the maxim is, yes, in today's world is. So Swamiji, if you can share with us a typical day in your ashram with all your fellow mates.
Okay. We give a lot of importance to meditation and seva. So we usually, when we get up in the morning, between say around 4, then we have our own personal meditation for an hour or two, and then we have group meditations again afterwards between 7 and 8, and then after having breakfast we have our office duties where we have our areas located, areas of service assigned to us. That is for about 6-7 hours, and then we have a break in between where we have half an hour of meditation. Evening again we have our own personal meditation, and before we go to sleep we again have a brief period of meditation. So we have between 3 and 5 sessions of meditations in our daily routine, which range between 1 to 3 hours depending upon different people. So that is our routine,
and that gives us eternal bliss.
That gives us eternal bliss, and that is the springboard for all the energy we get, you know, for the service we do. Without meditation, I don't think any of us will be able to do the selfless service which we are doing now.
Absolutely. Swamiji, your message for the viewers, please.
My message is, first of all, realize that we are not just this body. We have a invisible dimension which is called the soul, which is, though it is invisible, it is absolute reality. Just like even though we don't see air, without air we cannot survive. Similarly, without connecting with our soul in some way, we cannot survive. So realizing the importance of connecting with that inner spirit, we should give time for inner exploration and connecting with the divine. And all it takes is giving just 30 minutes in the morning and 30 minutes in the evening for meditation. Follow any path which suits you, which you are drawn to, but make sure it is genuine and then stay with it. So that would be my message.
Thank you, Swamiji, for giving us your valuable insights and inputs on this world of spirituality. And I hope the youngsters will take the message and lead on and take the baton forward. Thank you so much for giving us your valuable time to our viewers.